England, it could have gone over 1 to 1.1. Well, let's speak to Dr. Bharat Pankhania, a senior clinical lecturer at the University of Exeter in the southwest. He joins me from Bath this evening, a familiar face to Sky viewers. Thanks very much for being with us. So we're being told by the Transport Secretary we shouldn't be overly alarmed that in the southwest the R number could be as high as 1.1. What's your assessment?
All the parameters are there for us to have a rise in number of cases. The parameters are, we've got a lot of cases out in the community. I appreciate that they are dropping, but it's still not low enough. And therefore, when we start opening up, inevitably, we will generate new cases. And this creation of everybody watchfully watching the R number is almost a distraction, because what we need to look out for is the number of cases, the number of new hospitalizations, and that will tell us pretty well what the state of play is. And I expect it to rise, and I expect hospitalizations to also increase.
We have seen this regional breakdown today of the R number. Why do you think the Southwest is in the position that it could be in?
So the Southwest had a lucky escape in February, March, when we don't have as many travelers, visitors coming to our seaside resorts and holidays. And now that summer is almost upon us and we've got more traffic coming our way, inevitably people will bring infection down to the Southwest region, and then the locals will mingle with people who are holiday making. And as a result, we will get a rise in number of cases.
You speak in rather worrying terms about more infections, more hospitalizations. What are you basing that on? Is that because we're seeing the easing of the lockdown?
Indeed, very much so. And I feel that the easing of the lockdown is premature. And my reasons are as follows. We have a high baseline of community cases. Secondly, our contact tracing and our testing services are not universal and fully operational. And we know that the contact tracing application, people are now not talking about it. So our momentum to contain it is not fully in place. It's not even localized, it's centralized. And then we are opening up under a background of already a higher baseline of cases out in the community.
And yet, elsewhere in Europe, we're not seeing this second wave, are we? We're being told that we should be very concerned about a second wave, and yet we haven't really seen it in any huge way anywhere across Europe.
Yes, and they have an advantage upon us, and the advantage is they shut down earlier, and when they shut down and then lifted their lockdown, they lifted it at a level when the baseline number of cases was lower than in our country. So we were late going in, and then we are early coming out when our case numbers are still a little higher than we should allow them to be.
Yet today we are hearing shocking figures when it comes to the country's GDP, when it comes to the economy. We know that we need to kickstart the economy, or things are going to be even more serious than already being predicted. It is a balance, isn't it?
It is a balance, and I think we've made errors. And as a result of the errors made, we are playing constant catch-up, because biology doesn't respect economics. And what we ought to do is the scientists talk pragmatically with the economists and then come up with the best possible solution, which in a way we are. So now I would change my advice and say as follows. People who are at high risk of severe illness, please shield. People who will get an infection but invariably get better, you may go out, but please be careful. Don't get infected and bring that infection to vulnerable people. That way, we are striking a balance with opening up, but opening up carefully.
Let me ask you something else that came up in the news conference a bit earlier about face coverings. We're being told from Monday it's mandatory. We have to wear them on public transport. Is that enough, do you think? Would you like to see us having to wear them every time we go outside?
So wearing them outside is not going to help, because we're out there, out in the open, and only fellow humans can infect us. However, and people like myself have been saying so since April, that in a crowded situation, like our underground, like our buses, like our supermarkets, we ought to wear a face covering, be it a mask or a covering, to capture some of those droplets, which may make a direct hit upon others. So it's a case of, I don't infect you, you don't infect me, in crowded places. So only in crowded places. Otherwise, there is no need to wear it.
And very briefly, if you would, the WHO recommends 1 metre when it comes to social distancing. It seems our government is going to stick to the 2 metre rule for now, at least. Whose side do you fall down on?
I prefer the 2 metres because every distance away from another infectious human being is better. But if you are going to get closer, wear a mask. That will also mitigate against coming closer to other infectious human beings.
OK, always good to see you, Bharat Pankhania, Senior Clinical Lecturer, University of Exeter. Thank you very much.